Greetings. It was incredible to me when I first began learning of Islam and its claims and teachings. The first time I heard a Muslim claim Ishmael was offered for sacrifice, I thought, holy cow, why would someone make up this garbage? Let me just call it Replacement Theology 1.0. Before that evil doctrine of demons sprouted in Christianity, it was fully watered and nurtured in Islam. I even had a Muslim recently try and make this very claim to me. My friend, Bible is corrupted, especially the story of Isaac and Ishmael. I would ask you a question. Who is Ishmael? And was he legitimate or illegitimate son of Abraham, according to you? And we exchanged several cordial messages, but I did not let the false accusation of corruption go unchallenged. Okay, my friend, time to refute you. Let the book of Genesis speak now. Here is how they twisted the story of Isaac and Ishmael. Peace be upon them both. First, is Hagar his wife of Abraham, or not? We shall see. So after Abraham had been living in Canaan 10 years, Sarah his wife took her Egyptian slave Hagar and gave her to her husband to be his wife. And then he did what all Muslims are trained to do. Focus on the word wife and only the word wife. But here, for a broader audience and deeper consideration, is my answer to this point. You must dig deeper for the truth and not cherry-pick only one translation that fits your assumptions. He looked only at one phrase and one word in particular, wife, and eagerly thought, that is the only word that counts. But in the context, to be his wife is incoherent with the rest of the description. In fact, many translators do not say, to be a wife, but use as a wife. The New Living Translation. So Sarah, Abraham's wife, took Hagar the Egyptian servant and gave her to Abraham as a wife. The English Standard Version. So after Abraham had lived 10 years in the land of Canaan, Sarah, Abraham's wife, took Hagar the Egyptian, her servant, and gave her to Abraham, her husband, as a wife. The New American Standard Bible, took Hagar the Egyptian, her maid, and gave her to her husband Abraham as his wife. I think if you honestly read the context, you will see this is a euphemism. As a wife is the same as like a wife, meaning in Quranic verbiage, a tilth to plow. A tilth to plow as a surrogate mother. This is the only plausible reading if you would just read the previous verse, brother. So Sarah said to Abram, look now, the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Please go to my maidservant. Perhaps I can build a family by her. Abraham listened to the voice of Sarah. Sarah said, perhaps I can build. Meaning Sarah held claim to whatever offspring Hagar produced. I can build a family by her. I can build a family by her. This does not even come across as support for Abraham. Perhaps my husband Abraham can still be a great nation. No, that sentiment does not scream forth from the shadows of what Sarah actually said. If Hagar was a true wife of Abraham, no other woman could claim her offspring, brother. No, Hagar was a servant, a slave of Sarah. And as a slave of Sarah, Hagar does not seem to have rights to claim her own child. Sarah did not think so. Sarah thought Hagar was just a fertile tilth to plow for Abraham. Another statement Sarah makes is also quite telling of her thoughts and the reality. In verse 5, then Sarah said to Abram, may the wrong done to me be upon you. I delivered my servant into your arms, and ever since she saw that she was pregnant, she has treated me with contempt. How does Sarah describe the situation? Does Sarah say, after Hagar became your wife? No. Sarah says she delivered my servant into the arms, meaning bed, of Abram. Not a whiff of a hint of a lasting wifely relationship. The other piece of information all of Islam ignores is Father Abraham himself, brother. Not one time does Abraham refer to Hagar as his wife. Let us read the whole passage, and you can see for yourself if you will just open your eyes. So Sarah said to Abram, "Look now, the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Please go to my maidservant. Perhaps I can build a family by her." Abraham listened to the voice of Sarah. So after he lived in Canaan for 10 years, his wife Sarah took her Egyptian maidservant Hagar and gave her to Abraham to be his wife. And he slept with Hagar, and she conceived. But when Hagar realized that she was pregnant, she began to despise her mistress. Sarah was still Hagar's mistress, her owner. Then Sarah said to Abram, "May the wrong done to me be upon you. I delivered my servant into your arms, and ever since she saw that she was pregnant, she has treated me with contempt. May the Lord judge between you and me." Sarah calls Hagar my servant. Sarah, speaking to Abram, does not call Hagar your second wife, Abram. "Here," said Abram, your servant is in your hands. Do whatever you want with her." Then Sarah treated Hagar so harshly that she fled from her. Hagar fled from Sarah. Abraham, then Abram, calls Hagar your servant and does not call Hagar his wife, brother. Abram does not defend Hagar like a man would defend a real wife. The phrase "as a wife" means like a wife, but not a real wife. Only like a wife, meaning like a tilth to plow with seed. The problem with Islamic arguments, brother, is they never look at all the evidence for the whole truth. The only approach Islam knows is defend Muhammad, defend Muhammad, defend Muhammad, and twist any word or fragment to try and fit Muhammad's fairy tales. You wrote, "Now we shall see what does the name Ishmael means. The fact in Hebrew it means Yeshmael, God hears it. So it means God supported the illegal sexual relationship of Hagar and Abraham." It is irrational to attempt to conclude or claim that God supported the illegal sexual relationship, brother. You may be certain God knew that Abraham would sin with Hagar, because God knows the end from before the beginning. So God knew that Abraham would sire an illegitimate son by Hagar. But God was clear, brother, who would be the mother of the child that God would make his covenant with. To really understand, brother, you must read all of Genesis 15 through Genesis 17. God always refers to Sarah as the mother and calls Isaac by name, even though Isaac is not yet conceived. At first, God only promises offspring and does not say who the mother would be. Genesis 15:4, "And behold, the word of the Lord came unto him, saying, This shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come forth out of thine own bowels shall be thine heir." 15:18, "In the same day the Lord made a covenant with Abram, saying, unto thy seed have I given this land, from the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates. So here God speaks of Abraham's seed. 17:2, and I will make my covenant between me and thee, and will multiply thee exceedingly. That's talking about offspring. 17:3, and Abram fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, as for me, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. This gives me pause. God does not say one nation or the Jewish nation. God says many nations. Neither shall thy name any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be Abraham. For a father of many nations have I made thee. Nor does God say two nations, Jews and Arabs. And I will make thee exceeding fruitful, and I will make nations of thee, and kings shall come out of thee. And I will establish my covenant between me and thee, and thy seed after thee, in their generations for an everlasting covenant, to be a God unto thee, and to thy seed after thee. So God promises an everlasting covenant, an eternal covenant. If you think about it, God just painted a target on the backs of the Jewish people. Satan, the adversary of God, now has a target to attack, and if successful, thwart God's plan, and maybe prove he is not God. If Satan can slaughter every last Jew on earth, God has no covenant people. God's covenant is therefore not functionally eternal. And God said unto Abraham, as for Sarah, thy wife, thou shalt not call her name Sarah with an I, but Sarah shall be her name. And I will bless her, and give thee a son also of her. Yea, I will bless her, and she shall be a mother of nations. Kings of people shall be of her. God speaking, and speaking of Sarah. And God said, Sarah, thy wife, shall bear thee a son indeed, and thou shalt call his name Isaac, and I will establish my covenant with him for an everlasting covenant, and with his seed after him. Sarah, Sarah, Sarah. Now, if you are Muslim, do not freak out that I skipped verse 18 or 20. I am speaking of the mother who God calls by name over and over. There is no doubt, and no one will deny, that Ishmael had been sired by Abraham and was born to Hagar. But Wajid, you refuse to listen to God, brother. That is something you must face. Rejection of God's words is infidel behavior, and all who follow Muhammad practice this infidel behavior, brother. Hear God and listen to God, brother, if you want to please him. Abraham believed God, and it was credited to his scales as righteousness. Genesis 15:5, and the Lord took him outside and said, now look at the heavens and count the stars, if you are able. Then he declared, so shall your offspring be. Abram believed Jehovah, the Lord, and it was credited to him as righteousness. The problem arises with Islam refusing to listen to or accept what Almighty God said. The problem arises with Islam claiming, no, fabricating, that all this really spoke of Ishmael, born to Hagar. At stake is the eternal covenant and who holds the right to it. But this is the desperate and tragic ignorance of those in Islam. thinking they can replace Isaac and fool Jehovah God, thinking they can steal the blessing and the promise made to Isaac, and God will not notice. I can think of no better way to create the army of the Antichrist for the last days. We see it today, and it is the army of Islam, of Mohammedism, of Satan's false religion. It all goes back to Abraham's sin of unbelief that made him sire a child. Now, stop for one moment and think, especially if you just heard in your head, "And he believed the Lord and he counted it to him for righteousness." The Bible says that where there is no law, it says sin is not imputed. Romans 5:13, "For sin was in the world before the law was given, but sin is not taken into account when there is no law." But there is more to that than this video can hold. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.